Today I'm very excited to announce that we are going to be starting a new series called Navigating Linear Algebra. And especially if you've never seen linear algebra or higher mathematics before, one of the first questions that you may have is, oh, what is this series about? Well, there are many different ways that I can try to answer the question, but let me hopefully give you a visually appealing and somewhat lengthy answer in response. First of all, to even begin answering this question, we have to know informally some basic concepts. And one of the main ones that we're just going to see over and over again in the series is the concept of a vector space. And to be very informal, a vector space is a collection of mathematical objects called vectors, which we can add and scale. And we're going to make these two notions more precise in probably the next video. But for now, for the sake of getting more geometric intuition over addition and scaling, let us consider the most prominent vector space that we are going to focus on throughout the series, which is the vector space Rn. And here in particular, I have a graph of R2. So R2 is simply a collection of ordered pairs consisting of two real numbers. So for example, 2, 1 is a vector in R2. And in linear algebra, we're usually going to write this as a column vector with 2 at the top and 1 at the bottom. So 2, 1, as you probably know from high school, can also be thought of as this arrow to the point 2, 1. This orange arrow really corresponds to 2, 1. And if we consider another vector in R2, for example, 2, 2. So 2, 2 is going to be a vector that goes 2 to the right, 2 up. So this green vector is going to be 2, 2. There is a very natural way of adding the vectors in R2. For example, we can simply add component-wise. So we get 2 plus 2 for the first coordinate, getting us 4, and 1 plus 2 for the second coordinate, getting us simply 3. So that's going to be the vector 4, 3. That's going to look something like this. This red arrow is going to be the sum of 2, 1 and 2, 2. And in addition to this, there is a very natural way of scaling the vectors as well. For example, going back to just the vector 2, 1, we can simply scale this, for example, by 2 by multiplying 2 component-wise. So 2 times 2 is going to be 4, and 2 times 1 is going to be 2. So we get the vector 4, 2 by scaling this vector by a factor of 2, and 4, 2 is simply a vector that stretches all the way here, twice the length of the one we started with. And I should really hasten to add here that although R2 is a really nice example of a vector space where vectors geometrically can be visualized as these arrows, there are certainly many, many other vector spaces out there. For example, if you consider the set of all functions from R to R, from the set of real numbers to the set of real numbers, like for example, f of x equals to x plus 1 and g of x equals to e to the x, then certainly these functions can be added and scaled in a very natural way. For example, f plus g of x can simply be x plus 1 plus e to the x, and so on. So the set of functions from R to R is a vector space. And for example, the set of polynomials, the set of real polynomials is a vector space. The set of differentiable functions can be a vector space, and so on and on and on. But for now, let us shift our attention back to R2 and ask a very natural question. So we have these vectors that we're going to add and scale. Well, what else are we going to do? Well, what's the point of this? Well, as soon as we have this notion of vector addition and scalar multiplication, there is some very natural questions that come into light. And one such question is, given a vector space like R2 here, how can we deform a vector space into another vector space in a way that preserves or respects the vector addition and scalar multiplication? What do I mean by that? So what do I mean by respecting vector addition and scalar multiplication? What I want is as follows. So in R2, we have two very standard vectors. We have a vector that simply points 1 to the right, which we're going to call E1. And we have a vector that simply points 1 up, which we're going to call E2. And if we're going to deform R2 into R2, then one of the criteria that we may want the map to satisfy is that we want E1 and E2 to be sent to certain vectors. So for example, E1 goes to 1, -1, and let's say E2 goes to 2, 1. And in addition to that, we want the map to respect vector addition and scalar multiplication. And what this is going to look like visually is as follows. So we are going to get a deformation of the plane that looks something like this. And what's happening here is that our E1 was indeed sent to 1, negative 1. So this is where E1 was sent to. And E2 was sent to 2, 1. So right here. And what I mean by this respecting vector addition and scalar multiplication is that, for example, if we look at the vector 1, 1 here, this is simply E1 plus E2. You add E1 to E2 to get 1, 1. So if E1 is being sent to this vector, 1, negative 1, and E2 is being sent to this vector, 2, 1, and if we are respecting vector addition, we want this vector 1, 1 to be sent to simply the sum of 1, 1 and 2, 1. So we want to make sure that this 1, 1 is sent to this vector. So that's the part of respecting the vector addition. And respecting the scalar multiplication, of course, is analogous. So we want the vector, for example, 3 times E2. So this is a vector that stretches all the way like this. To be sent to 3 times where E2 is sent to. So you want that vector to be sent to this long arrow right here. And what we are going to see is that this map that sends E1 to 1, negative 1, and E2 to 2, 1, can also be described as a matrix. So this is one way of even defining a matrix, and we're simply going to put these two vectors together and say that this linear map, this map between the vector spaces, and due to this respecting property, you say that the map is linear, is going to be written as 1, negative 1, 2, 1. I guess I should quickly add that this pink circle right here is the image of the unit circle upon this linear map. So if you think about the unit circle belonging to here, and if you apply the linear map to that, then we're going to get the circle on the right hand side. And this picture alone that we have here already asks so many questions. For example, you can ask, can we go backwards? Does there exist a linear inverse? So is there an inverse to this map, inverse matrix that simply deforms the plane backwards to what it used to be? So this is a good question to ask. Another question that you can ask is that if you look at this area here of the unit cube, so if you look at this cube described by E1 and E2 with area 1, this cube is being deformed to this cube, this parallelogram right here. And the natural question is, what is the area? What is the area of this parallelogram? And this simple question actually leads to the concept of determinant. So this is going to be intimately related to the determinant of the matrix. Another question that you can ask is that if you look at this ellipse, what is the length of the semi-major axis? And the simple question actually is related to the concept of singular values of a matrix and even the norm of a matrix. And by norm, I really mean size. So if you're going to measure the size of a matrix, then one natural criteria that you can look for is what's the semi-major radius of this ellipse. So that's a way of defining the size of a matrix. Let us continue. Now let's say we have a matrix given by 2, 1, and 4, 2. So now our E1, so looking at this picture, is being sent to the vector 2, 1, and our E2 is being sent to this vector 4, 2. And now we have a very different picture at hand. Rather than having a two-dimensional plane, now we just have a line. So even though the input was two-dimensional, now the output was one-dimensional. So this is pretty fascinating, and we see that our ellipse has now become a line as well. And you may ask, why did this happen? Why, instead of getting a two-dimensional output, we got a one-dimensional output? Well, that's because there was some linear relationship between 2, 1 and 4, 2. In particular, you could go from 2, 1 to 4, 2 using vector addition and scalar multiplication. Here, in fact, you can simply scale by 2 to go to 4, 2. So there was a linear dependence between the vectors. And this concept of linear dependence is also one of the most fundamental aspects of a vector space that we are going to study over the series. So now let's consider this very nice matrix at 0, 0, 1, 0. So the output of this matrix looks something like this. So here our E1 vector has now been sent to just the 0, 0 point. So E1 vector was just sent to this point, whereas E2 vector was sent to E1. And this is a very interesting matrix. Because if you think about this, any any multiple of E1 has now become the single point. So in the original xy plane, the entirety of the x-axis has now become this single point. So the y-axis, which is given by the multiples of E2, so this is the y-axis, has now become the x-axis. So the y-axis has been flipped by 90 degrees to become the x-axis, whereas anything in the x-axis was sent to zero. And how we say this in the language of linear algebra is that the x-axis is the kernel of this map. And kernel is anything that's going to get sent to zero. So anything in the x-axis was sent to this 0,0 point. And in addition to the kernel, you say that the output of the linear transformation is the image. So for the matrix 2, 1, 4, 2, then the image of the linear transformation was this line. Whereas the image of the linear transformation for this matrix 0, 0, 1, 0 was the x-axis. So here we have a very interesting phenomenon for this matrix where our image is the x-axis, but our kernel is also the x-axis. And what this means, and you can try thinking about this, is that if we apply this matrix one more time, if we apply this matrix one more time just to the image of this map, then everything is going to be sent to 0,0. And another way of saying this, as we'll see in the future, is that when you square this matrix, you are going to get the zero matrix. So this is an example of a matrix whose square is a zero matrix. And whenever a power of a matrix is a zero matrix, you say that that matrix is nilpotent. So this matrix is an example of nilpotent matrices, which have a very rich theory on its own. And we can throw in so many more questions in addition to the ones we've asked. How do we generalize this to higher dimensions? Can we generalize this to 3 dimensions, 3x3 matrices, 4 dimensions, or even thousands of dimensions? And how do you work with matrices of that size? Another question, just going up, how do you know if I give you a bunch of vectors, especially in 3 dimensions or higher, how do you know whether they're linearly dependent or independent? And this simple concept is going to lead to one of the most fundamental ideas of row reduction and reducible row echelon form of a matrix. So we're going to study this as well. And finally, let me end this introductory video by asking one more question. And the question is about derivatives and differentiation. If you have studied calculus before, you know when you have a function from R to R, from real numbers to real numbers, the notion of derivative is intimately connected with the idea of approximating a function using a tangent line. But what happens in higher dimensions? For example, let's say we have a very non-linear function. So here we have a function given by xy, mapping to x squared minus y cubed, x cubed plus y squared. And here we have a very, very non-linear deformation of R2. And a very natural question is, what should be the notion of derivative in this higher dimension? Well, for example, if you look at a specific point, for example, if you look at point 1,2, that point gets mapped to -7,5, as you can compute. So that's a point lying around here. And a natural way of defining derivative is to consider what linear transformation is going to approximate our function near this point. And something you're going to see in multidimensional calculus or multidimensional analysis is that we can approximate the deformation here using a linear deformation that resembles what's happening here. So learning linear algebra is going to allow you to learn multivariate analysis as well. Anyway, hopefully this is enough of an introduction, and I'll give you a more abstract introduction in the next video.